Once you know the symbols for the most commonly encountered elements that you're going to see in the human body, the next thing to think about is what those elements are composed of. So what are elements made from? Well, the smallest unit of matter that possesses all the properties of a given chemical element is called the atom. And generally speaking, that's, if not the smallest, then one of the smallest particles that will ever be of interest to us in a human physiology course. Let's take a look at the parts of an atom in general, because all atoms have the same basic structure. In the center of every atom is what's called the nucleus. The nucleus is the core of the atom, and it contains two types of subatomic particles. Now, as a quick aside, physicists have been exploring deeper and deeper into the structure of subatomic particles for a long time now. We're going to hold the line at three subatomic particles only that we're going to deal with in human physiology. So the two that are found in the nucleus are the neutron, which has an electrical charge of neutral or zero, and the proton, which has a positive electrical charge. Now, just do some basic math in your head. Every atom in the universe has in its nucleus two types of particles, positively charged or zero charge particles. That means the net charge of every atom in the universe is positive. All atoms have a positively charged nucleus. Surrounding the nucleus is what's called the electron cloud, in which a third, much smaller subatomic particle called the electron is flying around the nucleus. These electrons carry an electrically negative charge, and these charges are going to be important as we go forward in other lectures. So if we look at a fairly simplistic Bohr-style diagram of an atom, and let me say up front, I understand why chemists don't particularly like this type of diagram for understanding chemistry, but since we're trying to quickly get into some biology, I'm going to use it because it's convenient. So let me be very clear. This isn't really what an atom looks like if we wanted to visualize it, but it's a simple way to get started visualizing it. And here we have an oxygen atom. So if you look at our oxygen atom, it contains a nucleus with protons and neutrons, and it's got electrons flying around that nucleus in different areas. Those areas are what are called electron shells. These shells aren't strictly locations, they're also about energy, because if you think about this, the negative electrical charge in the electrons ought to be attracted to the positive electrical charge of the nucleus, and yet the electrons are flying around, so there has to be some potential energy keeping them in these shells, and that potential energy is what we're actually going to be interested in more than just about anything else here. So these electron shells hold different numbers of electrons. The first shell closest to the nucleus holds up to 2. The second out from the nucleus holds up to 8. The third, which is not shown here because oxygen doesn't have the third shell, holds up to a maximum of 18. And we're really not going to deal with elements that have more than 3 shells in human physiology. The outermost of these shells is what's called a valence shell. So in any given atom, the valence shell is the outermost electron shell occupied by electrons. In our oxygen atom, the second shell happens to be the valence shell because it's the outermost shell with electrons. Having run briefly through the structure of an atom, let's take a look at how the periodic table relates to atomic structure. So since we've been running with oxygen, let's keep up that. Here is a typical periodic table entry for oxygen, and you see several things in this entry. In the center, we have the chemical or atomic symbol, O. Up top, we have the atomic number, which is a whole number. The atomic number is unique to each element, and it represents the number of protons in the nucleus of that element. Atoms are electrically neutral. If it's called an atom, it's electrically neutral. We'll deal with charged particles in another lecture. So if atoms are electrically neutral and protons are positively charged, that means the atomic number also tells us the number of electrons in the electron cloud for that atom. At the bottom, we see what's called the atomic mass. The atomic mass is the average mass in units called Daltons of all of the atoms of this particular type. You'll notice it's a decimal, but it's close to a whole number, and this is pretty typical. Each individual atom has a mass number, but the atomic mass is an average for all atoms of that element. Protons and neutrons have a mass of about 1 Dalton each, and electrons have what is in effect negligible mass because they're so tiny. So in essence, when we talk about a mass number for a single atom, which will be a whole number, that's the total number of particles in the nucleus. So All atoms for a given element have the same atomic number, and therefore have the same number of protons in their nucleus, but different atoms of the same element have different mass numbers. These different atoms with different nuclear masses are called isotopes. That's a term you'll see a few places. I don't deal with it a whole lot in my course, but it's a term that would be helpful for you to know. So let's summarize. The number of protons in an atom can be derived from its atomic number. The number of electrons is the same as the number of protons if it's an atom, so that's also the atomic number. And the mass number tells us how many particles are in the nucleus. So if we subtract atomic number from mass number, that tells us how many neutrons are in the atom. Let's just do a couple quick examples. Oxygen has atomic number, and the most common isotope has mass number 16. So with that in mind, this atom contains 8 protons from its atomic number, 8 electrons from its atomic number, and 8 neutrons, which is derived by subtracting 16 total particles in the nucleus. Subtract from that the 8 protons, which give us 8 neutrons. Let's do another quick example. Sodium has atomic number 11, and the most common isotope of sodium has mass number 23. So sodium atom contains 11 protons from its atomic number, 11 electrons from its atomic number, and 12 neutrons, 23 minus 11. And with that in mind, our next big topic down the line is going to be to talk about how atoms interact. And since atoms interact through their outermost points, which would be the valence electrons, guess what we're going to talk about next?